Good evening and welcome to our nightly telecast of Just the News, where we bring you a wrap of everything important that's happened in the country and the world in just about 10 minutes, which means we have no time really to give you our opinion on anything. This is only the information as you should know it. Now, obviously, the biggest story in the country right now is the spread of COVID in the second wave and the shortage of vaccines that have come with it. But before I get into the details of that story, there's one story that has not received enough attention across the country that I'd like to bring to you first. The state of Uttarakhand, which is also home to some of our most beautiful forests, has had at least 414 incidents of forest fires reported in just April alone, and we're barely 10 days into this month. Now, over 400 hectares of reserve forests, which are, you know, actually protected forests, have been damaged by these fires, and they continue to burn as we speak. Since January this year, there have been a total of 1,400 incidents of forest fires. Now, this is obviously worrying, not just for environmentalists, but it should be worrying for all of us, because these are precious, like I said, Himalayan forests. Plants, animals and national parks, unlike anywhere else in the world, and it's obviously integral when we consider the future of the globe and the country as far as climate change is concerned, if these forests are currently on fire. It's so bad, in fact, that the Uttarakhand Chief Minister, Tirat Singh Rawat, has spoken to the centre asking for help. The central government has given the state government two helicopters that are currently engaged in firefighting operations. There are also 12,000 forest personnel currently engaged in firefighting as well. Four people have died so far, two of whom were forest personnel. And we'll bring you updates on what's happening in Uttarakhand. But it's really something that I encourage you to read about and share and talk about a little more, because it deserves more attention than it's getting right now. Well, moving on now to information about the COVID situation across the country. The Prime Minister, in a virtual meet with chief ministers of different states on Thursday, asked the state governments to focus on night curfews and micro containment zones following the formula of test and track to bring COVID under control. The Prime Minister also proposed a Tika Utsav, or a vaccination festival, from the 11th of April to the 14th of April, and asked everyone, including young people, to come forward and help people eligible for vaccination to get immunized immediately. The country, in the meantime, reported a record high of 1,31,968 new cases of COVID. Opposition leader Rahul Gandhi has written to the Prime Minister asking for the vaccination to now be opened up to everybody. He also, on Twitter, took a dig at the Prime Minister's vaccine festival, saying the vaccine shortage in the country is a serious issue and it's not a festival. In the meantime, Health Minister Dr. Harshvardhan shared a meeting with a high-level group of ministers on COVID through video conference. Talking about India's vaccination drive, he said that more than 3 crore vaccinations have been administered to senior citizens so far. But he also talked about the fact that India has supported the global community through Vaccine Maitri, and 6.45 crore doses of COVID vaccines have been exported by India to 85 countries. He said 3.58 crore doses have been supplied to 25 countries under commercial contracts, which means they paid for it. 1.04 crores have gone to 44 countries as grants, and 1.82 crores has gone to 39 countries under COVAX, which is a global community supply of vaccination. Meanwhile, the health minister also dismissed the state government's claims that there is a shortage of vaccines. He said there's no shortage of vaccine right now. 43 million doses are currently in the pipeline. But I want you to just take a quick look at what various state governments are saying about this at this point. In Maharashtra, which remains the worst affected state, out of a total of 120 vaccination centers that were active in Mumbai, 70 vaccination centers were shut today by the end of the day because of a shortage of vaccinations. Maharashtra government said, along with Mumbai, they're also facing problems in Satara, Sangli and Panvel. Rajasthan has flagged a shortage as well and asked for immediate supply of vaccination from the center. The state government has said vaccinations have run out and it will run out completely in the next 2 days. Rajasthan Chief Minister Ashok Gehlot has asked the Prime Minister for 30 lakh doses of the vaccination. There's a very worrying situation currently brewing in Gujarat from the reports that are coming in from local media. Now, I'm quoting a report by the newspaper The Hindu. Now, Gujarat has recorded its highest single day count of new cases at 4,021 and 35 deaths. But according to a report from The Hindu, the official death figures seem to be, and I quote, highly underreported given the situation that is currently happening on the ground in cities like Surat, where apparently bodies are being sent to a nearby town of Bardoli for cremation because of the long lines already in Surat in the burial grounds and the crematoriums. On Thursday, as per the official bulletin of the government, 14 deaths were reported in Surat, but as per local media reports, 100 people have been dying in Surat per day over the last few days. Now, this is again according to a report in The Hindu. The local municipal councillor has been quoted by The Hindu saying that it is an extremely challenging situation in Surat because of the rise of cases. He's also said that there are no beds available in hospitals, no space in the crematorium, no medicines like remdesivir injections, shortage of ventilators and ICU beds. The situation is no better in cities like Ahmedabad, Vadodara, Rajkot, Jamnagar and Bhavnagar. Local media reports and TV channels show a number of bodies waiting to be cremated while there are no beds in hospitals either. In Madhya Pradesh, in Indore, there is a serious shortage right now of remdesivir and of oxygen supplies. According to authorities, the daily demand of remdesivir is about 7,000 in Indore, but they're receiving less than half that number. The district collector Manish Singh has said as a result of the rising number of cases of coronavirus in Maharashtra and Gujarat, the availability of remdesivir and oxygen has dropped in Indore, which is in neighboring Madhya Pradesh. In the meantime, the Indian Army Chief General M.M. Naravane has gifted 1 lakh COVID-19 vaccine doses to his Bangladeshi counterpart General Aziz Ahmed. General Naravane was visiting Dhaka. The visit comes less than 2 weeks after the Prime Minister visited Bangladesh as well. A quick look at all of the restrictions that have been announced by various state governments. The Karnataka government has announced night curfew in 7 cities from 10 p.m. to 5 a.m. starting tomorrow until the 20th of April. The night curfew will be imposed in Bengaluru, Mysuru, Mangaluru, Kalburgi, Bidar, Tumkur, Udupi and Manipal. Karnataka reported 6,570 COVID-19 cases and 36 deaths just yesterday. Odisha has made it mandatory for people coming in from other states to carry a negative COVID RT-PCR report. If you don't have that report, you'll be quarantined for 7 days in Odisha. This comes into effect from Monday, the 12th of April. The government has also suspended all public transport between Odisha and Chhattisgarh until the end of the month. In Delhi, all schools and colleges will be closed until further notice. Delhi reported 7,000 cases. It's its highest single-day spike this year. Schools and colleges have also been closed in Himachal Pradesh until the 21st of April. And the Tripura government has shut schools for classes 1 and 2. Although while there are announcements of schools and colleges being closed, there's been no clarity really on exams for the 10th and the 12th standard students on all of the boards, whether that's the ICSE, the CBSE or state syllabus, where most students are still preparing to actually take these examinations in the middle of what seems like a severe second wave and lockdowns in many of our states. It would be helpful, of course, for the boards to give clarity to students right now as to how this will happen. Moving away to news outside of COVID and the lockdowns, India and China held another round of military talks today at the Chashul border point on the Indian side of the line of actual control in eastern Ladakh. The talks were led by Lieutenant General P.G.K. Menon, the commander of the Leh-based 14 Corps. According to reports, the discussion centered around the topics like the hot springs, Gora and Depsang. The 10th round of military dialogue took place on the 20th of February, 2 days after both military sides concluded their withdrawal of troops and weapons from north and south banks of the Pangong Lake. Let's take a look at news coming in from around the world right now. Prince Philip, the longest serving royal consort in British history, Queen Elizabeth II's husband, passed away today at the age of 99. He was admitted to hospital in February this year, but went home after a month after he was treated for his heart condition and an infection. Prince Philip, who was born back in 1921, has been quoted several times saying that he was really a pillar of strength to the Queen in her entire reign as Queen of England. The royal family tweeted that with deep sorrow, Her Majesty the Queen has announced the death of her beloved husband. More bad news coming out of Myanmar. Myanmar's information blackout for its citizens has gotten much, much worse. Really, the last legal way for citizens of Myanmar to access the internet, which was the fiber broadband service, has become now almost inaccessible as several networks are now going down. This is according to a report by the Associated Press. Apparently, authorities in several areas have also begun confiscating satellite dishes, which are used to access international news broadcasts. Police have also raided shops selling dishes and the satellite dish, not the eating dish, and confiscated them. Meanwhile, 11 demonstrators have been killed in fresh clashes with security personnel as truckloads of troops have arrived to quell anti-coup protesters. So over 598 people have died and 3,000 people have been arrested since the coup was announced on the 1st of February. A look at news coming in from science and technology, and this is really fascinating. Archaeologists have discovered a 3,000-year-old lost city buried under the city of Luxor in Egypt. Now, renowned Egyptologist Zahi Hawass has announced that this discovery is being called the Lost Golden City. Is said to be the largest ancient city of Aten ever uncovered in Egypt. Now, the discovery of this lost city is the second most important archaeological discovery since the tomb of Tutankhamun in Egypt. That's really quite fascinating. In sports, China, which is set to host the 2022 Winter Olympics, has warned the US of a robust response if the US boycotts the event. Spokesperson of China's foreign ministry has said the politicization of sports will damage the spirit of the Olympic Charter and the interest of athletes of all countries. The White House has said that there is no boycott being discussed with international allies. In March, though, US, Canada and UK joined the EU to take what they described as coordinated action against China and send a clear message about the human rights violations and abuses allegedly happening in the country. This comes after human rights groups are mounting international pressure against China hosting the games to draw attention away from China's alleged treatment of the Muslim Uyghur minority, the Tibetans and the residents of Hong Kong. All right, and a piece of offbeat information that we leave you with before we wrap up the news. Elon Musk's company Neuralink has released a video demonstrating how a monkey was able to play ping pong using just its brain. Now, in the video, Neuralink demonstrated how it used a sensor hardware and a brain implant to record the baseline activity from the monkey's brain, and the monkey's called Pager, as it played a game on screen with a joystick. Now, after the implant was removed, the monkey was no longer able to perform the functions that it previously did. Now, with this demonstration, Neuralink aims to apply the same in humans. So, a person with paralysis will also be able to control a cursor on the computer using a brain implant. I'm going to leave you there. Thank you so much for listening. Remember, subscribe to our YouTube channel. If you want to read more about any of the stories you heard on this bulletin, the source links are in the description of the video on our YouTube channel as well. Share it. Tell other people that we're doing this every night so more people can find it useful. Leave us a thumbs up. It helps us. Enjoy your weekend. Stay safe. Stay home. Wear your mask. Thanks for watching.